Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Art History, A Very Short Introduction, Second Edition, by Dana Arnold, narrated by Suzie Althens. Publisher's Note: In this audio edition, you will hear references to visual elements present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Preface to Second Edition. This book is intended as an introduction to the issues and debates that make up the discipline of art history and that arise from art history's central concerns: identifying, categorizing, interpreting, describing, and thinking about works of art. The ways in which art history has approached these tasks have changed over time. These shifting attitudes toward the parameters of art history and how histories can interrogate visual subject matter have raised questions about the presentation of the history of visual art in written form and the limits verbal language has placed on our ability to do this. In recent years, the relative importance of the role of the artist, the subject, and the viewer in the artistic enterprise have also been reevaluated. These issues, in turn, raise questions to do with our preoccupation with authorship, authenticity, and chronologically defined linear progression, all of which have informed the traditional canon of art history, which may be only one way of looking at, analyzing, and historicizing art. Thus, traditional histories of art emphasize periods and styles and focus on Western artistic production, and this can obscure other approaches. For instance, the grouping of artworks according to their subject matter, or influence the way in which arts from cultures outside the West are discussed. This book challenges such traditional ways of seeing and writing about art. I have, therefore, chosen examples from different historical moments and cultures to illustrate questions that I see as fundamental to the subject. This being a very short introduction, I have been selective in my choice of illustrations, and the images I use are meant only to be indicative of the issues I discuss in relation to them. As a whole, the illustrations are representative of high art, that is to say, the art we expect to find in museums and galleries. This material enables us to investigate a range of social and cultural issues covered by art history. I begin with a consideration of the fundamental question: what is art history? This enables me to draw distinctions between art history and art appreciation and art criticism, and to consider a range of artifacts included in the discipline and how these have changed over time. Although art is a visual subject, we learn about it through reading, and we convey our ideas about it mostly in writing. This sets off an interplay between the verbal and the visual, which I explore in Chapter 2. Here, I look at how histories of art have been written in Europe and North America, and the effect this has had on the object itself and on the subjects of art history. Examples from a broad time span are used, including Pliny, Vasari, and Winckelmann, together with more recent writings by Gombrich, Greenberg, Nocklin, and Pollock. A discussion of these writers introduces the expectations we have of art history as a chronological story about great Western male artists. As part of this second edition, I have added a chapter on art history in a global context, and I consider the mismatch between Western approaches to art history when applied to art objects from outside this cultural and geographical purview. The bias in this interpretation of the subject opens up the questions of the importance of the canon in art history and how we view non-figurative, primitive, and naive art. The importance of the gallery or museum, or more generally of ways of presenting art history, is covered in Chapter 4, which maps out the development of collections from cabinet of curiosities to the private and corporate sponsor and collector of today. Since the first edition of this book, the emergence of the prestige building by a star architect to house art collections has become an increasingly global phenomenon, and I look at the impact this has on the presentation and our understanding of art history. Alongside this, I discuss the impact the amassing of objects has had on their perceived value and on the histories of art, and how writing about objects can affect their value. The question of the canon of art history returns in this chapter in relation to the ability of the gallery or a museum either to endorse or to challenge it. I look at this with special reference to the importance of the identity of the artist in gallery display and in answer to the question, what difference does it make to the presentation of art history if art is presented to the public as a thematic exploration of a subject or as a chronological sequence? This also informs my consideration of how blockbuster exhibitions have changed the direction of art history. For instance, the Post-Impressionism exhibition of 1912 that gave that art movement its name. Returning to the theme of global art history, I also think about how the blockbuster both facilitates and influences the movement of artifacts to audiences across the world. The relationship between art and thought can be a complex one. And in Chapter 5, I discuss the impact various philosophical schools and psychoanalytic theory have had on the way in which we think about art history and the role, meaning, and interpretation of art. I introduce the ideas of such key thinkers as Hegel, Marx, Freud, Foucault, and Derrida in order to show how they have interacted with art history, not least in regard to the emergence of social histories of art and feminist art history. Chapter 6 goes on to discuss the idea of meaning in art, in particular, the quality and kinds of representation, and the use of iconography, or symbolism, in artworks throughout history. In Chapter 7, I look at the different media and techniques used to produce art. As well as introducing ways to think about art and its history, I hope this book will encourage and enable the enjoyment and understanding of artworks themselves, and I want at all times to reinforce the importance of the art objects as our primary evidence, or starting point, for art history. To this end, Chapter 7 brings us back to the work itself. I draw attention to ways in which we might read the physicality of the object in terms of the technique and medium used to create it, as well as other methods we might employ for reading the visual. This book is intended to be of interest to the general listener, the gallery goer, the A-level student, and as a grounding in aspects of visual culture for first-year undergraduates studying art history, archaeology, and cultural studies. I have aimed to write the text without using jargon, but there are a number of technical and specialist terms that are essential to use and to recognize. Mindful of this, and the introductory nature of this book, I have included a full glossary of terms which provide a starting point for individual inquiry into works of art. It is my intention to give a clear, concise discussion of the complex debates within art history. I also want to equip the listener with the basic tools necessary for the study of the subject through a chronological and thematic coverage of a broad range of issues connected with the discipline. But most importantly, this book is an attempt to convey how much we can learn from art and to suggest a diversity of ways in which we can enjoy looking at it, thinking about it, and understanding its relationship to ourselves. Chapter 1. What is art history? Can art have a history? We think about art as being timeless, the beauty of its appearance having meaning, significance, and appeal to humankind across the ages. At least this usually applies to our ideas about high or fine art, in other words, painting and sculpture. This kind of visual material can have an autonomous existence. We can enjoy looking at it for its own sake, independent of any knowledge of its context, although, of course, viewers from different time periods or cultures may see the same object in contrasting ways. Art appreciation and criticism. When we look at a painting or sculpture, we often ask the following questions. Who made it? What is the subject? When was it completed? These are quite valid questions that are often anticipated and answered in, for example, the captions to illustrations in art books and the labels to works displayed in museums and galleries. For many of us, these pieces of information are sufficient. Our curiosity about the who, what, and when of art is satisfied, and we can get on with appreciating the artwork, or just enjoying looking at it. For those of us also interested in how, Information on the materials and techniques used might help us to appreciate further the skill of the artist. The important thing to note about this kind of art appreciation is that it requires no knowledge of art history. The history of an individual work is contained within itself and can be found in the answers to the questions who, what, when, and how. These are the kinds of details that appear in catalogs of museum and gallery collections, or those produced for art sales, where perhaps information about the original patron, if relevant, might also answer the question why. Auction houses, museums, and galleries also place emphasis on the provenance of a work of art. This is the history of who has owned it, and in which collections it has been held. This acts as a kind of pedigree for the work, and might be used to help prove that it is an authentic work by a given artist. All this information is important in determining the monetary value of a painting or sculpture, but need not necessarily be important for art history. In this way, art appreciation requires no knowledge of the context of art. The "I know what I like, and I like what I see" approach to gallery going is sufficient. And this is absolutely fine. We can enjoy looking at something just for what it is, and art can become absorbed into what might be called popular culture. Art appreciation can also involve the more demanding process of criticizing the art object on the basis of its aesthetic merits. Usually, aspects such as style, composition, and color are referred to, and more broadly, reference is made to the artist's other work, if known, or to other artists working at the same time or within the same movement or style. Connoisseurship. Art appreciation and criticism are also linked to connoisseurship. By its very name, this implies something far more elitist than just enjoying looking at art. A connoisseur is someone who has a specialist knowledge or training in a particular field of the fine or decorative arts. The specialist connoisseur may work for an auction house. We have all seen how on television programs, such as the Antiques Roadshow, experts are able to identify and value all manner of objects, not just paintings, on the basis of looking at them closely and asking only very few questions of the owner. This kind of art appreciation is linked to the art market and involves being able to recognize the work of individual artists, as this has a direct effect on the work's monetary value. A connoisseur's taste in relation to art can be considered to be refined and discriminating. Indeed, our concept of taste in relation to art is quite complicated, and inevitably, it is bound up in our ideas about social class. Let me take a little time to explore this more fully. I have already discussed the practice of art appreciation, art available for all and seen and enjoyed by all. By contrast, connoisseurship imposes a kind of hierarchy of taste. The meaning of taste here is a combination of two definitions of the word: our faculty of making discerning judgments in aesthetic matters, and our sense of what is proper and socially acceptable. But by these definitions, taste is both culturally and socially determined, so that what is considered aesthetically good and socially acceptable differs from one culture or society to another. The fact that our taste is culturally determined is something of which we have to be aware, and this crops up throughout this book. Here, though, it is important to think about the social dimension of taste as having more to do with art as a process of social exclusion. We are meant to feel intimidated if we don't know who the artist is, or, worse still, if we don't feel emotionally moved through the exquisiteness of the work. We have all read or heard the unmistakable utterances of these connoisseurs, but luckily, their world does not belong to art history. Instead, art history is an open subject available to everyone with an interest in looking at, thinking about, and understanding the visual. It is my intention in this book to describe how we can engage with art in these ways. History and art. The interaction between history and art impacts on our understanding of artifacts from the past. We are used to using written documents as evidence in the construction of history. However, the physical remains of the past can also make history visible. They allow us to see the past with our own eyes. This concept is not new. Autopsia, in other words, eyewitnessing the past, was a term used by the Byzantine humanist Manuel Chrysoloras. Moreover, the rediscovery of the artifacts of the past by antiquarians from the Renaissance onwards enhanced textual histories. Historians continue to employ images as if they were a scientific technique of observation of the past. Yet, as we will see, realistic representations such as John Constable's The Cornfield or Velasquez's Las Meninas are more than just evidence of a rural idyll or what a royal family looked like. The testimony of images, especially prints, photographs, and film, which are contemporary to the events they describe, is powerful. Today, the ever-expanding realm of media through which these images are available only serves to enhance their potency. But these images are all modes of artistic production, and choices have been made in their execution. I find some tension between the truthful status bestowed upon art by historians and what these images might actually be doing. In other words, the images, just like historians, act as interlocutors between the viewer or reader and the event. The choices made in the depiction of history are as subjective as those made by the historian when he or she formulates his or her narrative. Here we have to differentiate between the kinds of images used by historians, the visual art from the period under discussion, and depictions of historical events produced at a later date. In addition, the subjugation of images by some historians to illustrative ephemera on the margins of their true history denies the fact art has its own history with its own dynamics and is not just in the service of other narratives. History as progression. For art to have a history, we expect not only a timeless quality, but also some kind of sequence or progression, as this is what history leads us to expect. Our history books are full of events in the past that are presented as part of either the continual movement towards improvement, or as stories about great men, or as epochs of time that stand out from others. For instance, the Italian Renaissance or the Enlightenment. In regard to these kinds of frameworks for thinking about the past, the history of art does not disappoint. In the coming together of these two separate strands, we see how history reorders visual experience, making it take a range of forms. The most popular of these include writing about the history of art from the point of view of artists, usually great men. Alternatively, we find art historians have sought to define the great stylistic epochs in the history of art. For example, in the Renaissance, Baroque, or Post-Impressionism. Each of these traditions can be written about independently of the others, and they have provided a backbone for histories of art. Here I use the plural, since the results of each of these ways of writing about the history of art are different, placing different emphasis on what is important. In some cases, the artist, in others, the work or the movement to which the work belongs. The problem with concentrating on formal elements, such as style, is that style itself becomes the subject of discussion rather than the works of art. As we become preoccupied with marking out stylistic changes, we have to use our knowledge of what came after the work under discussion. The benefit of hindsight is essential here. How else could we know that the beginnings of an interest in nature and naturalism in the art of early Renaissance Italy prefigured the consummate achievements of artists of the High Renaissance in this regard? Working backwards from the present imposes a line of development of which the outcome is already known. In this way, tracks or routes through the art of the past can favor certain styles. This is certainly the case with classical art and its reinterpretations. Also, histories of art that focus solely on style can easily neglect other aspects of an artwork, such as its subject matter or its function. It is possible to narrate a history of artistic style using representations of the male and female body. This might begin with the representation of physical perfection achieved in ancient times by the Greeks. By the Middle Ages, however, there was little interest in the naturalistic depiction of the human form. But by the Renaissance period, increased knowledge of human anatomy and nature meant that art had become more lifelike. But this kind of history could also be told using representations of cats and dogs, although most would agree that domestic pets have not been a principal focus for artists over the last two millennia. Yet style has played a significant role in the formulation of histories of art. And it is only in recent years that the notion of stylistic progress in Western art has been reassessed. Indeed, the emphasis on style leads us to expect the notion of progression and constant development in art. If we want art to represent the world we think we see, then we can impose an expectation of a continual move toward naturalism. But how do we then think about art that is not interested in naturalistic representation? This kind of abstract or conceptual art can be sidelined and deemed of secondary importance. Sometimes it is labeled primitive or naive art, with a pejorative air. In many ways, modern art confronts this prejudice, but often provokes cries of, "Is it art?" In the case of biographical histories, we look for evidence of youth, maturity, and old age in the work of an artist. This works quite well if the artist lived for a long time, but an untimely death does not lend itself to this kind of narrative arch. Claude Monet's early work, The Poppy Field, differs from the cycles of pictures of the same object at various times of day he produced in the 1880s and 1890s, as seen in his views of Rouen Cathedral, or haystacks. But although we can see similar preoccupations in the interest in light, shade, and color as a way of modeling form, these phases of Monet's career stand distinct from his late works, such as the large-scale paintings of the lily ponds at his Japanese-style garden at Giverny. This kind of biographical approach isolates the artist from their historical context. We often forget that Monet's late works were painted in the early 20th century, at the same time as Picasso was experimenting with cubism. Is there then a distinction to be made between the interaction of art and history, and art history? That is to say that histories of art can have a single focus on style or the work in relation to the biography of the artist, where our expectations of a progressive history are inflicted on the visual. What I am suggesting here is that we turn the question on its head and put art in the driving seat, so to speak. By using art as our starting point, we can see the complex and intertwined strands that make up art history. This implies that art history is a subject or academic field of inquiry in its own right, rather than the result of the rules of one discipline being applied to another. I return to this point on a regular basis in this book. I aim to set out how histories of art have been constructed, to describe the ways in which we have been encouraged to think about art as a result, and also to introduce other ways of thinking about the visual in terms of its history. Evidence and analysis in art history. It is important to discuss what kind of archive art history can draw upon, as the range of material used to construct these histories extends well beyond the works themselves. For instance, history has its documents, written records of the past. Archaeology focuses on the material record, physical remains of the past, whilst anthropology looks to social rituals and cultural practices as a way of understanding past and present peoples. Art history can draw upon all these archives in addition to the primary archive of the artwork. In this way, art history is the stepping stone into various ways of interpreting and understanding the past. In contradiction to this, the canon of art, as it is known, regiments our understanding and interpretation of the evidence. For art history, the canon has usually, but not exclusively, been associated with the traditional values of art. As such, the canon is artwork regarded by influential individuals, not least connoisseurs, as being of the highest quality. Consequently, the canon plays an important role in the institutionalization of art, as new works can be judged against it, and it is used as a means of imposing hierarchical relationships on groups of objects. This hierarchy usually favors the individual genius and the idea of the masterpiece. Moreover, the canon promotes the idea that certain cultural objects or styles of art have more value, both historical and monetary, than others. One of my principal interests in this book is the impact of canonical works that are considered defining examples of taste and of historical significance on art history. I have been using the words art and visual almost interchangeably. This raises another important question. What are the subjects of art history? Traditionally, the history of art has been concerned with high art, but a range of artifacts has been included in the discipline, and these have changed over time. When talking about the Renaissance, for instance, it is quite easy to confine discussion to known artists such as Michelangelo or Raphael, and to works of paintings or sculpture, or their preparatory processes, such as drawings. But the remains of the visual outputs of different cultures and epochs are quite varied and invite a range of interpretations. We are all familiar with the rock art of prehistoric times, but the reasons behind its production and who produced it remain enigmatic. We look at the cave paintings at Lascaux in the Dordogne, France, and see in them hunting scenes, depictions of everyday life. But rock art also includes abstract designs and shapes. So, could this kind of art have had a more mystical function? Some argue that these images are the work of shamans, members of a religious cult who used hallucinogenic drugs as part of their practice of worship. And these images come from the unconscious as a result. A different question arises if we look at ancient Greece. The world inhabited by this civilization is seen as a high point in the history of art. But most ancient Greek sculpture is known only through Roman copies, a problem discussed in more detail later on. And we have very little knowledge of ancient Greek paintings. Partly in response to these gaps in our knowledge, attention has focused on Greek vases, which, even from as early as 800 BCE, were decorated. The plentiful remains of Greek vases demonstrate a range of painting styles, from the geometric designs of the archaic period through to the silhouette-like bodies on black figure vases and the more painterly, fluid representations of the human form on red figure vases. These relics from the past are everyday objects, yet perhaps due to the paucity of specimens of high art, they are venerated examples of ancient Greek art. Perhaps unsurprisingly, their history is mapped against that of Greek sculpture and is the story of ongoing development in the pursuit of the representation of human physical perfection. In the case of non-Western art, everyday objects, sometimes referred to as material culture, are the best evidence we have for the artistic output of a given society. A Mayan vase may well tell us something about the religious or social rituals, as well as indicate the way in which artists chose to represent their world. However, in later periods in Western art, vases and other everyday objects have not always enjoyed such attention. Even the exquisite designs on the soft-paste porcelain of the Sèvres factory or the classical scenes on Wedgwood vases take second place to the high art of the same period, at least as far as art historians are concerned. It is important to remember, however, that ceramics and furniture were often considered more valuable and prestigious possessions at the time of their production than were painting or sculpture. So the emphasis and value we place on high art may, in fact, misrepresent its significance in the eyes of contemporaries. And the way in which art history can distort objects in terms of their contemporary and present-day meaning and significance is something I return to at various points in this book. In recent years, the term art history has itself come under question. The so-called new art history, now more than a generation old, sought to reassess the way in which we think and write about histories of visual objects. New art history was particularly influenced by theoretical ways of thinking about art to bring out its social, cultural, and historical meaning. I discuss the various ways of writing and thinking about art history in subsequent chapters. It is enough to say here that the notion of works of art having historical meaning beyond their role in the narrative of the work.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.